Good morning. Welcome to the 12th meeting of 2017 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. The committee has received apologies from David Stewart. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everyone present to ensure their mobile phones are on silent for the duration of the meeting? Agenda item one, can I welcome Richard Lyle to the committee and also invite him to declare any interests he may have that are relevant to the work of the committee. Mr. Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. It's good to be back. I'll refer members to my register of interests. I believe there are no other interests that I need to register.
Thank you and welcome to the committee. The second item on the agenda is for the committee to consider whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are we agreed? We are indeed agreed. We move to agenda item 3. This is to take evidence from two panels on petition PE1615 by Logan Steele on behalf of Scottish Raptor Study Group on state-regulated licensing for gamebird hunting in Scotland. For the first panel, we're joined by the petitioner, Logan Steele, and Andrea Hudspeth, the treasurer of the Raptor Survey, treasurer and Raptor Surveyor of the Tayside Raptor Study Group. Good morning to both of you. We're going to move straight to questions. Can I ask you, Mr. Steele, to begin? Can you outline for us the issues around raptor persecution that have prompted you to bring forward this proposal for a licensing system?
Yes, I will. Raptor persecution has been sadly endemic within Scotland for quite some time. Scottish Raptor Study Groups, along with other agencies, have sat and discussed and negotiated with those from the shooting industry. And over many decades, we seem to have made very little progress. And there's an element of frustration now with the Scottish Raptor Study Groups that we're seeing several ongoing scientific peer-reviewed reports detailing the absence of key raptor species on ground predominantly used for driven grouse shooting. And in a nutshell, that is really why we've put the petition forward and why we're here today.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on. Maurice Gold.
Just to expand on that a little bit, what evidence is there that the problem exists specifically over the last few years, and are there any specific geographical hotspots for this?
Yeah. Well, the evidence that you need really is just to look at several scientific reports that have been produced in the last 18 months. We've had the Northeast Scotland peregrine population has been reviewed in moorland. That's been indicated a decline on driven grouse moors. We've had a hen harrier population northeast of Scotland, of which I was a co-author, evidencing a decline of hen harriers on driven grouse moors. We also had a report on red kites in the Black Isle published last October, clearly indicating the red kite population is hemmed into the Black Isle due to raptor persecution. And we had the very good news about the Golden Eagle Survey report, which came out recently, showing a recovery in the population. But again, in northeast Scotland, on driven grouse moors and in southern uplands, golden eagles have got a very low occupancy rate where they are found. So there's the evidence. I know people are inclined to point to body counts as being an indicator of raptor persecution, but the numbers go up and down depending upon chance locations and chance findings of birds of prey offences.
So just to clarify, are you suggesting that the issue around raptor persecution is entirely linked to driven grouse moors?
Raptor persecution is found right across Scotland, but it's particularly intense on driven grouse moors. This is because the industry that drives driven grouse shooting requires a large surplus of birds at the end of each season to shoot for the guests. Without that surplus of birds, the industry would not exist. So therefore, every legal and illegal means are taken to reduce the number of predators that could prey on the surplus of birds. So there are legal means by killing vermin, such as you can kill and trap stoats, weasels, foxes, crows. So that's legal. But what's happening is on driven grouse moors, we're having some estates now persecuting birds of prey because, like I say, they threaten their business model.
Can I just clarify something? When you talk about the peer-reviewed evidence that's available, yes. How far back does that cover? And how far back do you feel it's appropriate to go for it to be relevant to the current situation?
That's a good question.
Well, I mean, certainly, raptor study groups have been collecting data since the 80s. Mm-hmm. So I'd say through our studies, we have numbers and trends that we can actually see. Mm-hmm. I think if we go back some of the papers, it is in sort of the last decade or so where we can see that the management has become more intense. And, you know, in line with that, that seems to go hand in hand with the raptor persecution. I mean, like I say, we've been studying raptors since the 80s, so certainly there have been papers generated since that time up to the present day.
Speaking personally, I'm responsible for coordinating the Morning Chief Golden Eagles west of the A9th in Tayside. So my data set goes back to 1983. So every year, the same sites are visited, and we're building up layer upon layer of data. So that's one example of one piece of science.
Yeah, I think what I'm getting at is in terms of what's prompted this, what's driving it, is it a concern that, say, over the last 6 years, the situation has worsened? Or would you go back to the early 2000s when one can point to examples in particular parts of the country where there was a significant problem? There may not be quite so significant a problem in those parts of the country. What I'm getting at is, what's driven this? Is it the fact that, say, over the last 5 years, you have seen it worsening?
Well, what's driven it is primarily the intensification of driven grouse shooting. We're seeing more and more grouse moors becoming intensified, and it's becoming quite a good business model. Some people are investing money in buying driven grouse moors to force the bags up. And the more you can shoot off a moor, the higher the value is perceived to be. Therefore, the more you can charge guests the following year. So it's become a business now. And raptors, quite frankly, are seen as being an impediment to that business. And the Cabinet Secretary said herself that it's a risk of business that raptors are on the ground and legitimately taking food.
So this is about the present day and a worsening situation from your perspective?
Well, we know it's worsening because we can look back at the history and the data sets going back many years, and we can see an intensification, and we can also see going back many, many years of species surveys, as Andrea said, a continual decline or a non-recovery in some areas.
OK, that's useful. Thank you.
I think the other thing, sorry, just to add to that, because you were asking, but the other thing we obviously have now is the improvements in technology that we have to actually track these birds' movements. And so it's the satellite tagging data as well, which is, you know, there's been some high-profile cases, say golden eagles and hen harriers going missing, etc. So this is also what has led us to this position. Basically, now we have more evidence and more data through this new technology.
Okay, thank you very much. Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Logan.
Good morning, Angus.
Andrea. If I could turn to the environmental impact. Clearly, there's been some disagreement about the environmental impact of game bird hunting, and your petition refers specifically to the potentially adverse impacts of game bird hunting. So could you give us the evidence with regard to the extent of these impacts?
Yes. Well, again, driven grouse moors need to be brought up to an optimum level to generate lots and lots of red grouse. So we're seeing hill tracks being put out onto the tops of the moors. We're seeing deep peat burning. And some of you may have seen reports recently about the huge fire that took place on Moy Estate recently. There was a big fire up near top of Dalnaspiddle, and huge acreages of heather are burnt. Best practice would suggest that the burning is done in small strips, but we're finding, in some instances, huge areas of moorland being torched. We're finding medicated grit being laid out for birds, and there's a question mark regarding the medicated grit, which is coated with an intense chemical, as to whether that's going to the food chain. So that's some examples of the impact. We're also seeing severe water runoff causing pollution problems in some localised areas as well.
You'll be aware of the statement from Tim Baines, the Scottish Moorland Group's evidence to the Public Petitions Committee when this was looked at last year, that management of grouse moorland has a positive net contribution to the environment. What's your view on that statement?
Well, there is an argument that says that where you have driven grouse moors, you have a higher increase in the number of waders, for example, like golden plover and curlew. And that's quite right. If you remove all the predators including legal and illegal removal of predators, you will get an increase in the number of birds which do not threaten red grouse stocks. So golden plover and curlew are mentioned specifically. But interestingly, the PSAC committee, which was published in 2014, indicated that in the UK, 180,000 woodcock and 130,000 snipe were killed in that particular year. So the interest and concern for waders is appropriate, but not appropriate in other areas as well.
Okay, thank you.
Question of peat burning.
Yes.
And the Muir Burn Code. And I'm not seeking to put words in your mouth, but I want to run this by you. One of the activities that has been suggested to myself that takes place is that rather than directly persecuting hen harriers, there are examples where slopes which would provide habitat for hen harriers are burned contrary to the Muir Burn Code. Therefore, you remove the habitat, you remove the hen harriers from being there in the first instance. Yes. Is that something that you're aware of, conscious of?
Yes, I'm aware of slopes where peregrine have nested, burnt out. I'm aware of heather slopes where harriers have been either breeding historically or are showing a degree of interest being torched out. And Andrea and I have a particularly unpleasant example. I monitor one pair of golden eagle, and the pair have five eyries, four in one glen and a very old one in the other glen. And this particular year, the pair of golden eagles had gone from the traditional glen over the top into neighbouring glen, and they started showing interest in a rock where an eyrie was to be built, and a whole hill was torched. We've got photographic evidence of that. So that's an extreme example of what happens on some driven grouse moors.
And when an instance like that occurs, as the Raptor Study Group, do you engage with the landowners responsible? Do you seek to find out why they're doing it? Do you ever get an answer around that?
Well, I was going to say, in those particular examples, it's a good case in point, is that we don't meet the landowners. The particular estate that Logan is referring to, there's a management company that actually runs that one, and I've never actually come across the owner. I don't know who owns the estate. So the only people I can talk to on the ground are the gamekeepers. And they've just been less than friendly, let's say, and not really wanting to engage at all in any conversations.
We tend to have good relationships with the large majority of people on the ground. So we work well with crofters, shepherds, farmers, and lots of gamekeepers. Where we find a particular issue is where you've got driven grouse moor management, and they're loath to engage, and as Andrea says, they're quite cold and unwelcoming. We have tried to make approaches to them, but it's futile.
But is it all grouse moors, or is it just the ones that are most intensive?
It's intensive driven grouse moors, where the business model generates a large volume of surplus birds to be killed. Walk-up grouse moors, there is not a problem. Well, I say there's not a problem. Generally speaking, walk-up grouse moors are fine because the business model they have there is that guests will walk up a hill and shoot grouse that flush from their feet, and they tend to be happy with the experience, the day in the hill, the odd bird for the bag, as opposed to driven grouse shooting, where they're trying to shoot huge numbers and get big bags.
OK, thank you. OK, moving on. Mark Ruskell.
Convener, good morning. We've had some evidence from the Game Wildlife Conservation Trust, where they listed all the legislation, regulation, voluntary codes of conduct that relate to game bird shooting. Now, that's not a coherent licensing scheme in itself, but it does represent a range of forms of separate regulation that are applied to that sector. So in your view, why is that current system of regulation not working? And is it a matter of that the regulations aren't suitable, or is it about the enforcement and the policing of those regulations?
Yeah, I mean, enforcement is a big issue. Certainly, the authorities don't have the time or the resources to actually put the checks and balances in there. So, and as you said, a lot of these codes of practices, I mean, they're voluntary codes of practice. But if nobody's actually checking those, that's just where the system, current system, doesn't work. I'm sure there are lots of people out there who are looking at those code of practices and they are following them. But there certainly are others who will maybe, take a few chances, contravene some of the regulations to their own economic advantage. But certainly, again, it's remote areas, it's rural. It would be very difficult to, without the resources, to actually police these things. And that is the problem we're finding, because we're out there, and we're kind of out there with no backup, so to speak. So we will witness that things aren't, you know, procedures aren't being followed, but we don't have the backup of someone else there to sort of corroborate what we're seeing. So certainly we feel there needs to be extra regulation, and that regulation has to be backed up by proper enforcement.
So answer your question.
Well, I'm just wanting to tease out a little bit more about the current state of the regulations and the legal frameworks that we have. I mean, are those adequate? There's the separate issue about policing and enforcement, but are you content with the current legal frameworks that if they're enforced, should protect raptor species and the environment?
The legal framework we have is good. We've had lots of the previous governments have brought in new legislation, new actions, and vicarious liability was perhaps the most high profile of that. But enforcement of the law is a major issue for reasons Andrea mentioned, that we need two independent witnesses to corroborate an offence. So whilst there is a good suite of legal tools in place, it's still inadequate to crack down on the driven grouse moor element, which quite frankly seem to be running fast and loose with the law. They don't seem to be concerned, because the chances of being caught are very small, and then the chance of prosecution is very small, and the chance of a successful conviction is even smaller still. So my view is that they're very much aware of the legal tools in place, but they're happy to take the risk.
Mm-hmm. So a licensing scheme then would effectively allow enforcement of existing laws? You're not looking for even more stringent protection of raptors, because we already have that in law, but you're just looking for a way for that to be enforced, is that
yes,
right?
Yes, what we'd like to see, and it's not to us, of course, but we'd like to see licensing introduced based on civil basis rather than a criminal basis, because that's where it's falling down. There's plenty of legislation in place, good legislation, but the problem is, as Andrea again has mentioned, getting evidence and getting a conviction in law. That's the issue we have at the moment.
Well, looking at the review of the licensing systems elsewhere in Europe, you'll see that their legislation sort of goes hand in hunting and conservation go hand in hand. And actually what we see is that as there being an opportunity here to have further legislation that actually has a requirement on providing environmental benefits with the management of these hunting estates. So that's what we think would help. I mean, yes, it will. We would hope that would help with raptor persecution, but also we're hoping it would have some wider environmental benefits attached to it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Kate Forbes.
A lot of some of the regulations are relatively recent. And obviously, particularly vicarious liability, where I believe there's only been two convictions. Is there not an argument to be made that it needs to have time to settle down and to be used more before introducing additional regulation and legislation?
Well, sadly, we have had ongoing raptor persecution for, sadly, decades. And with the introduction of vicarious liability, we've seen no diminution in the number of offences. Against that, we've seen an increase in intensification of grouse. If I got a pound for every time I was offered a new initiative, a new action, give time for this, give time for that, let's do this, let's do that, I'd be a rich man. And vicarious liability, whilst it's very valuable and a very powerful tool, is just one more offer hope that I've been given personally over the years. And in the 6 years it's been introduced, again, we've got science here produced since it's come out, saying there's no diminution in the killing of birds of prey.
I mean, I'd say we're running out of time, really, for some of these populations, particularly if you only got to look at the status of the hen harrier in England. Well, we certainly don't want to get to that situation in Scotland, so we need to act now. So I'd say we don't really have that much time. I mean, as you said, there's only been two successful prosecutions of vicarious liability. I mean, how much time do we think we can give it, really?
Which presumably comes back to the difficulties that Mark Ruskell mentioned in terms of enforcement. And you touched briefly on why, in your view, it would be easier with a licensing system to have better enforcement. Could you expand a little bit on that, based on the fact that currently with these two convictions, it's been very difficult with two witnesses, etc., finding dead birds. It's been very difficult to prove.
I would draw a parallel between SNH's withdrawal of general licences. You may be aware they've withdrawn the general licence from two estates, and that wasn't removed on the basis of criminal evidence, it was removed on the basis of civil evidence. And I'd very much like to see any petition that might be introduced being based on the same principle. And I think that would make a big step change in the levels of enforcement.
How do you respond to the concerns that have been raised by some, and one might say that they would say this anyway, that if such a regime was not carefully drawn up, that estates could be the victims of being set up? I mean, that view has been expressed. How do you respond to that? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think it would be down to the drawing up of the licensing requirements. And, yeah, I suppose ultimately that could be a fear expressed by some. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to think that any requirements and regulation drawn up remove that. But, yeah, I can see a concern. But also make the point that we're here today because of the inactions and inability of the driven grouse sector to clean itself up. Mm-hmm. So for them to be concerned now about the possible implications of a licensing regulation, they've had a long time clean their act up, and they've been dragged kicking and screaming to the stage we're at today, when we're having to talk about spending a huge amount of time and resource asking a small element of criminality to stop breaking the law. So therefore, I've got some sympathy with that view, but equally, they've had it within their own gift to sort it out up until now. And
okay.
They haven't done so.
A further devil's advocate question.
Yes.
You've touched upon the existence of licensing regimes elsewhere in Europe.
Yes.
But those countries still have raptor persecution issues to some degree.
Yes.
So that wouldn't be a reason not to introduce a licensing system. Mm-hmm. But would you accept that simply introducing a licensing regime wouldn't necessarily put an end to raptor persecution?
No, it wouldn't. It would reduce it considerably. But there'll always be somebody somewhere in some remote estate who raises the rifle to an eagle or a harrier. But no, it won't stop it out and stamp out entirely. One thing I would say, that the SLE submitted a paper just before this meeting and highlighted the fact that thousands of raptors have been killed in Europe, and quoted a bird life report from 2011. That was factually incorrect. The killings that are taking place in big numbers are more to do with in Malta and Cyprus. And it's not high numbers of raptors that have been killed, but high numbers of birds in general. So a slight misunderstanding there.
Okay. Okay, let's move this on. Emma Harper.
Good morning, panel. In the Public Petitions Committee, Logan Steele, you said that you're not against game bird shooting and you've got no wish to ban it. So I'm interested in exploring what would the solution be in a system of state-regulated game bird licensing. You've talked a little bit about civil licensing. So would it be licensing for all game bird hunting, or who would require a license? What might be required to obtain a license in terms and conditions, and who would administer or enforce this licensing?
Well, one possible variation is that the shoot manager be licensed. In Europe, licensing is done on the estates, be it private or public, and also individuals are licensed. But the thought that we have, and I'd say that any regulation would be introduced with involvement with all interested parties, we'd see a shoot manager being licensed. So, for example, if there's a driven grouse moor in whatever area, that person there would be responsible for what happens on the ground. That's how it would operate. And we'd see the whole system be monitored through the government agency, which is currently Scottish Natural Heritage, and they'd be responsible for overseeing that activity. So I don't feel I've answered your question in its entirety. Any other points?
Well, I'm assuming it would be the SNH that would be overall that would monitor it or process it, which has other issues of, I guess, logistics and finance and everything around that as well. So I'm assuming that it would address the problems then of illegal activity. Is that what you're suggesting? Because conveners saying that wouldn't stamp out.
No, it wouldn't address the matter entirely. It would hopefully reduce it to a far lower level than it currently is. You talk about finance. Interestingly, In Europe, in the 14 countries reviewed by this report, quite a lot of them charge for a licence, for a permit to go hunting. And in many cases, a lot of that money goes a long way to offset the cost of actually running a licensing system, which might offset the impact on SNH of extra cost.
Okay. I just have one more point. I've spoke to a lot of people in the South West recently that mm-hmm. have concerns about increased number of hen harriers, not reduced numbers, and they're saying that it's affecting other species. In particular, they're talking about lapwings that they don't see on the ground anymore. Mm-hmm. So I just wonder what your thoughts are about it. I mean, people are saying one thing, evidence says another thing, you know. Mm-hmm. The evidence needs to be definitive about the numbers of birds that are increasing or decreasing, mm-hmm. whether they're raptors or lapwings or other birds.
That was just about to come in on. In a lot of these systems within Europe, data is collected, so bag data, etc., and they do a lot more studies of populations of birds in general in an area, so you've got an idea of what is sustainable to hunt and, you know, what populations, what are natural fluctuations are, etc. So yeah, and we're hoping that this sort of system would actually mean there is a coordinated approach to actually working out population levels of different species. But to ask, you know, to answer your question about lapwings, etc., I mean, hen harriers, there's no association of hen harriers and taking out lapwings, for example. I wouldn't have thought a hen harrier would have a detrimental effect on populations of lapwings.
I was assuming it was the eggs that they go after.
No, hen harriers predominantly take small prey. They will take grouse chicks, they'll take small voles, but they'll take other small pasturing birds as well, but they don't...
So meadow pipits, for example.
Don't take eggs, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
But there is a general feeling in the countryside that there's too many raptors, and there's too many buzzards, there's too many harriers. But one thing I would say is that the environment controls the population of raptors, not the other way around. And there's some evidence for... Local surveys are indicating that some raptor numbers are starting to decline. Buzzards, for example, have restored their levels to a natural population level, but we're seeing some regional declines. So this concern that buzzards are breeding and increasing beyond all recognition is not quite entirely correct.
Okay, thanks.
Clarify something. Are you looking for a one-size-fits-all national system, or would you favour, I think it's in Germany, where there is local variation across the various bits of the country. I mean, I'm just thinking from the point of view of, we all know there are hot spots in Scotland. Would you be looking for a system that could be tweaked to address that, or would you look for a system that was just nationwide?
I wouldn't be bold enough to predict what it would look like. I think it's up to the people or the architects of any licensing regime that's drawn up. But it's a good point that you make, because there are primarily five key hotspots for raptor persecution. So perhaps when the architects of the licensing regulation are drawn up, some care might be taken to that. But you're right, in Germany there's a national application, and then on top of that, the local governments can apply enhanced regulation mm-hmm. with regards to that, and that might be a good way ahead.
Just for example, in the national park,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
You know, would that perhaps work? That in the Cairngorms National Park, as an example, you could have enhancement there.
I would have thought that licensing against persecution would be uniform across Scotland. Where it might be tweaked, I cannot begin to imagine what sort of tweaking would be required for trying to limit or stop the killing of raptors that wouldn't be applying everywhere else in Scotland. But yeah, it's a good point. Probably worth delving into more deeply, but I wouldn't be too binary to say it would be this or that.
Yeah,
I think we need to be open-minded and speak with all stakeholders to come up with something that works for everybody.
Mm-hmm. But I think any system that has the collection of data as you know, built into it is going to be helpful towards looking at populations of birds and, you know, whether we have different levels in different areas, etc.
Okay. Yeah. Have you thought about the resourcing of such a scheme? Because stakeholders, the government...
Yep.
Parliamentary committees are very good at finding things for agencies to do.
Yes.
But then they have to have the resources to do that, and we all know that SNH's budget has been stretched. Mm-hmm. Do you see this as a self-financing licensing regime?
Yeah, I would like... Again, I wouldn't be too prescriptive, but yes, if you look at the European models, Most of them are cost neutral in that the cost of the licensing tends to cover the cost of the extra work involved. And we wouldn't want to see any additional financial burden placed on SNH for administering this scheme. After all, the people who are enjoying the benefits of shooting should be paying to cover the administrative cost of that. And indeed, some countries in Europe, of the 14 surveyed, some money goes back into active conservation management. But again, that's back to the point that Andrea made. In Europe, there tends to be a culture of hunting. In Scotland and the UK, it tends to be shooting. And I think that's a very interesting dichotomy. And I think that's why the European system seems to work well in some of the 14 countries that's been highlighted. Okay.
Right, thank you. Claudia, very much.
Convener, good morning to you both. And I wonder if you could, either of you, could pinpoint the main ways in which the system you propose will really robustly contribute to addressing the problems that we've heard about. Just in summary, that would be very helpful.
Well, if, for example, we have one of the five hotspots, we're finding a continual finding of instances where illegality is actually taking place. So we've had instances of meat being laid out, which has been laced with poison. We've had a number of birds disappearing in specific areas. There could be some best practice not being adhered to for muir burning, for example. We could find an increased number of nest failures. We could find areas of suitable habitat being burnt out. Those sorts of evidence, which again would not be criminally provable, but if we had a civil burden of proof, we could find lots of evidence of illegality, but no silver bullet, as it were, to find. That's what I'm trying to get to, would be a layering up of evidence of instances.
But I think also the system that we're looking for, if it's self-financing, but part of that finance would go towards the enforcement, i.e. actually having people on the ground. So at the moment, there's not that many people proactive. We don't proactively go out. The police force don't have the resources to proactively go out and look for wildlife crime. But what we're saying is this kind of system where there's a regulation in place, somebody has to enforce it. This will require somebody to be out there checking the thing, you know, people are following the correct procedures. So from that point of view, we're hoping that that would be a deterrent for people. If they know there are people watching, there are people who could just turn up and make spot checks, etc., we are hoping that would be a deterrent.
And if you look at some of the European countries, they've actually got a force of conservation officers. France in particular has got over 1,000 conservation officers, part funded by the money raised from licensing. So you could arguably have a force of environmental police officers working in of the five areas, perhaps, paid for, cost neutral, taking more of an interest in wildlife crime than the usual Bobby who's very, very busy with other matters.
While you've highlighted the issue of it's difficult to find whether there has been a crime committed and the different burdens of proof in relation to civil and criminal law, how would you see it working in terms of the terms and conditions which might have to lead to the withdrawal of a licence? I know that's a difficult question, but if you could give us a sense of that, I think it would be helpful.
So what do you mean by terms and conditions?
Well, there'd be terms and conditions for a licence. If you gave the example, I think, Logan, of the shoot manager, but that was one way forward.
Yes.
That there would be those terms and conditions. If those terms and conditions weren't honoured, how would you see the process whereby a licence could be removed?
Well, I would like to see, again, it's not up to us entirely, but in the licensing, you'd be asking for a number of land management techniques to be adopted and to be adhered to. So, for example, as I saw myself just a few months ago in one particular area, a whole hillside being torched, which is against the Moorland Forum's best practice. That would be an example. If we had instances of other instances of illegality taking place, but not enough to bring a criminal persecution, you could see an estate putting in hill tracks onto hills which hadn't gone through the proper regulation. If you have deep peat burning, if you have moors being drained, not being wetted properly, things like this, that they're not adhering to best practice. Does that answer your question?
Yes, that's helpful, thank you.
Thank you.
Just to get a feel for that.
Thank you.
Mark Roskell.
You mentioned the role of SNH in running this potential licensing regime. Would you see a role for the SSPCA in some way?
I'd like to see the SSPCA being brought in to use their skills and expertise to perhaps fill gaps where the rural police doesn't have the reach or time to do that. I think that would be very helpful, but fully appreciate it's on the Cabinet Secretary's desk at the moment, but they do have a special skill set that could be brought to bear, yes.
Yeah.
Few questions. Given the concerns raised by Emma and others earlier, have you considered the environmental, economic and community impacts on such a licensing system?
Can you explain what you mean by that?
Well, we've heard from Emma that there's some people have got concerns that there might be an impact on raptor numbers or whatever. What sort of work and what investigations have you done into what the environmental and cultural impact of the licensing would be over what we've got now?
Well, I would turn that on its head and say that I would ask the question of the shooting industry what impact they've taken on impacting on green tourism. So we know there's a £1.4 billion spent per year on green tourism, an SNH figure, and employs 39,000 people in green tourism. I'd ask the shooting industry what impact they've done when they undertake driven grouse shooting and impact it's having on other people who could legitimately enjoy a business from that same area.
Well, I'm sure they'll do that in the next session, have you done any work? There's always two sides to every story. Yep. Have you done any work to look at what the negative impacts may be?
Can I just make the point that Raptor Study Group is voluntary? We all have other jobs. This is something we go out and do in our own time. And we actually perform a very important function in that we are collecting all this data and we're doing it voluntarily and we give this data to SNH and the Rare Breeds and Birds Panel, etc. I don't think any one of us would actually have the time or the expertise to actually undertake such a study that you're suggesting. Yeah. So we would probably ask that the government would look into having an independent body to do such an investigation. And I think the economics of this, whether it's green tourism and shooting industry, this does need to be investigated further, and we would expect that to be done as part of this review of the system.
Perhaps to back up Mr. Carson's point, let's forget about a formal study. You've put a lot of thought into this petition. You've come today clearly having thought through a lot of the provided answers to a lot of the criticisms that we've been made of what you're proposing. Mm-hmm. One of the criticisms that's out there, rightly or wrongly, is that if this was introduced, you might see some estates back away from driven grouse shooting, and that would have an economic impact on the locality. Gamekeepers would lose their jobs, allegedly. How do you respond to that? I presume you've thought about that.
Yes, we have. We're not against shooting. We're not asking for grouse shooting to stop. And we'd be more than happy if intensive driven grouse shooting reverted to walk-up shooting. And we'd still have keepers employed, we'd still have the usual infrastructure, we still have the revenue coming in from guests at times of the season. So we don't see it being a major impact. All we're asking to do is the illegal element of grouse shooting to stop, and therefore every start obeying the law, and we'd still see keepers employed, estates, estate houses, guests coming up, hotels, that sort of thing.
So we just need to get that clear.
That's a good point.
Sorry.
Yeah, again, what other pros and cons do you see? I suppose it's a carry-on from the question again. Do you see in the licensing system? I understand that in Europe, the licensing system, in many cases, is based on hunting licences on public land rather than private land. Have you thought about that? And also another point, what would happen, for example, if a tagged eagle disappeared from a certain estate? Would that result in that estate losing its licence? And what would happen if that bird turned up a year later somewhere else in the country? How would you go about enforcing that sort of thing?
Well, again, it's not for us to draw up the minutiae in detail around that, but I wouldn't see a satellite tag Golden Eagle disappearing over one of the five hotspots and then being a ban, the police would be involved, there'd be a criminal investigation, they'd look for evidence, and then on the balance of that, if they didn't find the dead body or the satellite tag, I wouldn't see that going from there to straight banning of shooting licences. There need to be a tiered approach, and there need to be a number of instances over a period of time before some action was taken.
So why would that be different from what we've got in place at the moment? Pardon? Why would a licensing system make that process any different?
A licensing system would make a difference because any action would be taken on the civil burden of proof, not criminal. So where you had a number of instances of evidence of illegality and you went to the civil burden of proof, that would take us to a situation far quicker and easier than one requiring a criminal burden of proof, which, as we know, is very difficult to achieve.
And just, can you address the point about the licences in Europe being based mostly or generally on public land rather than private land?
Well, the reviews has reviewed 14 different countries where the licensing applies both to private and public land. Mm. And in the summary document, it makes it quite clear that despite the ownership of the land, be it private or public, legislation can work across both sides of it. Mm-hmm. But again, that's only for 14 different European countries. What happens in Scotland would be unique to Scotland, and I think a lot of best practice could be drawn from the 14 countries to bring up what is appropriate for the Scottish setting.
Okay. Thank you. I think it would be feasible and practical to go through what's happening elsewhere and pick and mix, essentially.
Well, possibly. I think it would provide a good starting spot, but of course, we are different from everybody else, and there would be a lot of local input. A lot of the laws that we see in other 14 countries are based on historical, cultural, hunting-type background. We're different over here, but it would be a good starting spot.
Mm-hmm. OK. OK. Any other members, any questions? OK.
Sorry. Briefly, obviously, you've mentioned Europe quite a number of times and sort of start using that as a starting point in terms of modelling a licensing system. And yet the SNH report made clear that there's still, obviously, raptor persecution in the European countries. What do you think, in terms of looking at that, it's obviously not perfect, in other words, is the point I'm trying to make. Is that something that you would accept?
Yeah, I mean, I'd certainly accept it, but if you actually look at all those different case studies, in a lot of them, it's improved the situation with raptor persecution. I think there's only a handful that say they still have a bad, you know, there is still a severe problem with raptor persecution. I mean, as Logan said, you're always going to have it. There'll always be an element of criminality, you know, across all sectors. So, you know, we're never going to get rid of it completely. But I mean, if you look at the Spanish example, where the BirdLife Partners worked with the government there, they've made great inroads into tackling raptor persecution. So I think that just goes to show that when people work together and they're on the same page, you can actually achieve great things. So, you know, that is our hope, really. We want to work with all the other stakeholders and we want to come up with a system, you know, that works for everyone.
There's a super example talking about Spain. There was an instance a few years ago where a farmer laid out poison bait and killed 6 imperial eagles, which are really, really rare birds. And following that, there was a huge increase in the number of public awareness, a free phone number, and that whole lot of information and dialogue was set up around that. And that initiative has brought 30 convictions, that spotlight being turned right on this particular issue. And the farmer in question was given a very, very hefty sentence, not just financial, but imprisonment, and also an obligation for him to provide money to try and restore the beagles that he killed. And also the Spanish are quite innovative because they've actually applied a monetary value against each bird of prey. So when a bird of prey is killed, they can then fall on an economic value to that bird, rather than saying, well, it's just 6 imperial golden eagles.
Thank you very much for the evidence you've given. I'm going to suspend briefly till we switch over the panel, and we'll see you in the next panel as well, Mr. Steele.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We now suspend. This meeting of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. We continue our discussions with stakeholders on petition PE1615 by Logan Steele on behalf of the Scottish Raptor Study Group on state regulated licensing of game bird shooting in Scotland. We're joined now by Duncan Orr-Ewing of the RSPB, David Johnson of Scottish Land and Estates, Andy Smith of the SGA, and Robbie Kernahan from SNH, and again by Logan Steele. Welcome back and welcome, gentlemen. Moving swiftly on to questions, I wonder if I can get a general comment from the panellists who've just joined us around the comments from Logan Steele earlier about raptor persecution and whether there is a specific problem around the areas of the country where there is intensive game bird shooting going on. Is it as widespread a problem as has been suggested by some, or is it done by a small rogue element? Who wants to go first? Duncan or Ewing?
So just to take the last point first, the RSPB has for quite a number of years catalogued instances of wildlife, confirmed instances of crimes against raptors in Scotland, and we produce an annual report on the illegal killing of birds of prey. And over the past 20 years, we have identified 779 confirmed incidents on 200 land holdings in Scotland. So we think this is a widespread problem. However, our main concern does relate to areas of land that are managed for driven grouse shooting, where the illegal killing of birds of prey appears to be on a large number of these places part of the business model. And we think the situation is as bad as it's ever been, and the recent Scottish Natural Heritage Scientific Advisory Committee review of moorland management has also indicated an intensification of the management of these areas in recent years, predicated on trying to increase grouse bags to very high levels.
Okay. David Johnson.
Yeah, thank you very much. It'll come no surprise that I don't accept the presumption that's coming from here. The government's own statistics show quite clearly that there's been a decline in the last 5-6 years relating to birds of prey crime. Can also caveat by say this, we do not in any way, in any shape or form within an organisation, condone wildlife crime of any sort, be it raptors or whatever kind you see. And we've been working extraordinarily hard with the government, with the PAWS working group, to identify the issues surrounding it, to deal with the issues, to make recommendations, to ensure best practice, and I'm sure we're going to come on to discuss a lot of the legislation that's already been changed and how it's working. But no, I do not accept what Duncan is saying at all.
Can I just put a devil's advocate question to Mr. Johnson? The figures you refer to from the government might be skewed by virtue of the fact that the increasing regulatory regime that's been introduced might lead those who are carrying out the crimes to hide the evidence. I've never understood the logic of committing a crime, murdering a bird of prey, and leaving the evidence for it to be found. Now, with the introduction of vicarious liability, general licences, etc., is it not possible that we are simply not seeing the evidence of these crimes taking place because people are hiding it?
No. Since the Scottish Parliament came into power, we've got the right to roam legislation. There's more people wandering around the countryside with social media, with cameras and everything else. The scrutiny has never been higher. The police have the ability to take access and enter without a warrant to look at premises. The RSPB have cameras, hidden cameras, filming what is going on. So the level of scrutiny has never been higher. The estates themselves are absolutely clear and aware of that. And they are bringing in practice, they're bringing in expertise, lawyers, etc., to address and tell their employees exactly what the law is, how it's to be enforced, how they have to behave. So there is no... it is not unequivocal. It's not equivocal at all. Everybody knows exactly what they are to do and what the law is. So, the improvement is marked.
Okay. Andy Smith.
Yeah, similarly, we do not condone any of the wildlife crime that happens at all, and we are very keen for our members. And I've said before in this committee, any of our members that have been found guilty of any wildlife crime is expelled from our community. It's not what we want. It's not what we're trying to do. Once again, we hear the words endemic across Scotland, and then, oh, it's in driven grouse moors and intensified driven grouse moors. And similar to what David was saying there, the Scottish Government figures that have been recently published show a massive percentage drop, 26% drop in the border prey crimes in the last 12 months, 40% drop in border prey crimes in the last 3 years, 85% drop in poisoning cases between 2010 and 2016. But again, we acknowledge that there was a problem going back to the RSP when they went back to the 20-year plan that they continued to bring out, but it's gone downwards since then. On some of the other things that we've seen as well, when the endemic killing of raptor species, according to the BTO, the buzzards are up 23%, ravens, although not raptors, are up 41%, red kites are now off the endangered list, sea eagles reintroduced and increasing. If this was an endemic crime that was happening all over Scotland, you wouldn't have buzzards, you wouldn't have ravens all over Scotland as we do now.
But the fact is that both the SGA and SLE, you're right, you do utterly condemn these kind of activities.
Absolutely.
But you don't represent everybody out there and you can't control your membership. So there's no doubt there is a problem here that needs to be addressed.
Given what David said earlier, I know myself from my own point of view that you have to make sure these days that the vicarious liability is a big thing now. And there are courses all over the place. A vast majority of keepers, I think, there'll not be many keepers that don't go on a vicarious liability course at some stage in their careers. So they're all over the place. And we certainly try and make sure that everybody goes on one at the local estate. And most estates take that on board as well.
It is being addressed.
OK. Logan Steele.
I would challenge the assertions by our speakers here to talk about the number of prosecutions declining, the number of dead bodies declining. It's just not reality. I refer to the four recent scientific reports that have come out in the last 18 months for kites, hen harriers, peregrines, and lastly, the golden eagle. The populations are in decline. They're not recovering. They're still suffering from historical lows. So for this to be not an issue and being evidenced by this body count, it's not reality.
Okay.
We're also about to hear, we're about to hear very shortly the results of the satellite tag survey, and that will be quite interesting as well.
Okay. We've heard all the polarised views with respect. Robbie, yes. Kernahan from SNH. What's SNH's view of the situation?
Okay, good morning, thanks. And I think my starting point is probably slightly different from everyone else's, and I think generally in Scotland we've probably got quite a positive message to tell about the recovery of raptor populations in Scotland from these all-time lows, certainly a national picture. But that's not to say that there are not issues. Certainly some of the concerns about the intensification of moorland management prompted our scientific advisory committee to have a review 2 years ago, and without wanting to go through that chapter and verse, there is no doubt that ongoing issues of raptor persecution is inhibiting the recovery of populations in some parts of the country.
Okay, thanks. Okay, let's move this along. Mark Ruskell.
Just following that, I mean, what's the core issue here? Is it about raptor persecution in isolation, or is it about the intensive high-density game bird systems that we have? Because, I mean, you seem to imply there that there's a wider issue with these systems.
Well, I think, bearing in mind, even this morning, we've touched on a whole range of things about the management of driven grouse moors. Some of those concerns are what prompted the Scientific Advisory Committee review in SNH about what evidence is there to suggest that type of intensification of land use is having a detrimental impact on biodiversity generally. Now, it didn't come up with any clear-cut conclusions, but there are some issues in there of which raptor persecution is one. We've already heard about muir burn, about tracks, about deer management, about mountain hares. There's a range of things in there which were of sufficient concern to prompt that review. And it came out with a number of recommendations for further work, some of which is still ongoing. So we're here today to talk about licensing of game bird shooting, but it's just symptomatic of some of the concerns which exist about land use and how intensely grouse moors are being managed.
Can you have some other views about the, perhaps from the industry and the conservationists as well?
It's about the intensification.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the previous session I heard a bit about labelled it towards intensive being the area of greatest concern. These are some of the estates which have put in the highest calibre of good management to ensure that all the employees, etc., that work within the estate are fully aware of everything that's going on. They've taken what happened in 2009 Act through vicarious liability and all the rest of it, and they conduct regular seminars with the staff. They bring in outside professionals to explain chapter and verse exactly what is needing to be done. If you went back to, say, 15 years ago, 2004, before the previous Act came in, I would suggest that some of the contracts that existed between the employers and the employees wouldn't even have existed, probably wouldn't even have been a bit of paper, it would have been a handshake. Now, they are very carefully laid out. It is crystal clear exactly what the rules are, what the regulations are, what you cannot do. And I'd say that the best practice has improved dramatically over the last 4 or 5 years, and that's what we're seeing the result filtering through.
So could that be the basis of a licensing regime then?
No, licensing, you're talking about something completely different.
If there's already compliance with, you're stating that you think there's already compliance with the various regulatory regimes.
So the regulatory regimes...
Like a licensing regime?
So the regulatory regimes that have come about through the Wayne Bill, etc., have created good practice and gone beyond that to ensure adherence to the good practice. What you're talking about within a licensing regime is bringing in a different level of proof, the sort of civil burden of proof, which has a much more dramatic effect upon the ability of business issues, et cetera, to operate efficiently and safely without risking their investments.
But yeah, I think you've just stated, though, that there's already training and accreditation that happens within a state, so...
Yes.
Exactly how hard would it be for you to then move to a licensing regime that effectively reflects the regulations that you say that the majority of states...
Within a licensing regime, what you're talking about here is not on the burden of criminal proof, you're on the burden of probability, removing the ability for that business to trade. And so if they lose that ability to trade, then that's the business finished. They just can't no longer take part in the business. And therefore, that alters the risk of running that business considerably. Because within a sporting business, it doesn't matter whether it's upland, grass shooting, or lowland, pheasant shooting, or anything else, there's a period of time at which you are bringing the customers in and interfacing with them. And if you have an issue that rears at the start of that, you lose the whole season. All the income's gone, everything's finished, and your business is no longer viable.
I'm struggling to understand why those businesses would actually be at risk. Because I mean, what we had in evidence was a list of all the regulations and laws and good practice which the states are meeting, mm-hmm. and you just explained how you're putting in place the training and the appropriate record keeping to ensure that that is done. So what would be the risk of you failing to meet a licensing regime if you're actually already meeting the legal terms and conditions and good practice that already exists? I'm struggling to see what the extra burden is or what the risk is to a business that is already fully compliant.
Because the risk of what you're talking about here is with a license, from my understanding, is that it's to be a lower burden of proof. So that if something is found to be untoward that's happening within an area where shooting is going on, then the right for that, the license for that area can be removed. Now, that doesn't mean to say the person or the people involved in that area have been convicted or thought to do anything wrong, but your ability to trade has gone. You've suddenly changed dramatically the risk of operating that business. And that, it's, running a shooting business itself is a very difficult business, a very finite margins. And things that change that risk profile will make people think twice.
But if that lower burden of proof was actually based on evidence, still has to be based on evidence that's brought forward, and if you've already got systems in place to ensure compliance with existing regulations and laws, I still don't see what the risk is. I mean, you seem to be saying that, well, that there would be a risk of us getting caught.
No, it's not a risk of getting caught.
It's
a risk that's been discussed in the previous session, that if somebody interfered with, a larceny trap on the estate and the license was removed because of damage to that larceny trap that the state didn't have anything to do with, the license is suspended, that business stops while it is sorted out. Now, that's a huge risk to bear within that from the activity of somebody else going on when you haven't yourself done anything wrong. So I think that's what the difference is here, is the changing of the burden of proof.
So can I just respond? So I think, in terms of the illegal killing of birds of prey, that is part of a package of issues that are causing concern at the moment in the way large swathes of upland Scotland are managed. And the SNH Scientific Advisory Committee review of moorland management has highlighted how in recent decades the intensification of grouse moor management in particular has caused this concern. And part of the issue that we have here is that unlike other natural resources management in relation to game bird hunting, we have no real assertion of the public interest. So if we look, we've been considering the deer issue fairly recently. Of course, we have a Deer Act, we have a Deer Code, which sets out what the public interest looks like. What David Johnstone and others are referring to are largely voluntary codes that the sporting sector promote and encourage adherence to. But, you know, when you're out on the ground, I'm afraid the picture that you see is very different, that a lot of these voluntary codes are simply not being adhered to. I mean, the Muirburn Code being one example. We've heard some examples there of bad practice, the code of shooting practice. I'm afraid, you know, with the illegal activities that are going on, we see lack of adherence to that. We have the code that the Scottish Land and Estates, GWCT, drafted or drew up with Scottish Natural Heritage in 2014, which related to the culling of mountain hares, following public concerns on that issue. And again, simply, when you're out on the ground, you see lack adherence to these so-called industry standards. So I think what we need in place is a code which better defines the public interest, sets out clearly what that looks like, and the expectations on the industry linked to a licensing system.
Before we move on, David Johnstone, this may be difficult to answer, but if one accepts, even if one accepts that your members are following these codes, you don't represent all the landowners in Scotland. No. Roughly speaking, how much of the land in Scotland is managed out with your membership?
Oh, blimey.
I know it's a bit of an unfair question, but I'm just trying to get a feel for this.
That's a very, very good question. We probably get about 70% of estates in Scotland. What that relates to landmass, I would be guessing. I would be guessing. So I mean, we have a good percentage of our members.
You're still talking about...
So the majority of it would come under our membership, I would imagine.
But roughly a third isn't. So even if your good influence is brought to bear on your membership, there's still a third of the land out there.
Yeah, but even within those third that acts with our membership, they're exhibiting good practice as well. I mean, we accept that within any industry, whatever walk of life you're with, there are people that are bad eggs who will do stuff that is illegal. But I don't recognise this conversation that's beyond that it's endemic. I think it's become the exception. The culture has completely changed over the years within the landowning community.
Okay, thank you. I recognise it was an unfair question, but
I can get back. I can work it out and get back to you.
It would be useful to have that. I think to have that information. Sorry, go back to Mr. Roscoe's question, Andy Smith.
Yeah, just to let you know some of that. I mean, you've obviously got a list of some of the acts that are covered that are not codes that are actually legislation, and they are quite widespread that cover both individuals. One of the big things that you've got, two of the big things you've got in Scotland just now that don't require a massive civil burden of proof is your firearms legislation and also your general licence, which is issued through the Wildlife and Countryside Act and through SNH. They're both contained in legislation. They already have a civilian burden of proof. The police will remove firearms from a gamekeeper if he's suspected of any wildlife crime. Similarly, and that's a bit akin to having a joiner having his tools removed from him. It's exactly the same sort of thing. So that is a pretty hefty sentence, if you like, in itself. We have quite stringent, in this country, we have a very, very stringent firearms policy, and it's not an easy thing to get a firearm in this country. You've got to go through a lot of processes to get that. Similarly, the general licences, and more recently, when they've been removed, purely on suspicion, and it's perhaps not just on suspicion, there's suspicion with evidence, obviously. That in itself is another tool that's taken away from us. That then can lead to individuals which are then under the spotlight, which I'm right in saying, they can reapply, and then but it's absolutely under the spotlight. That in itself is a massive, massive tool. I don't know if licensing would make that any different. I think it's got that already. I think you have that in place already, and I don't think it would make a big difference. On the licensing thing, if you go down the licensing thing where you have a license purely on a game board shoot, some of the things that's already happened to us, and this is some of the things that we've recorded from our members, we've had traps being sprung regularly, both upland and in lowland. Set snares have been removed. Untagged snares have been hung on estate fences, which obviously, and again, snaring, every operator of a snare has to go through our training course. Every operator of a snare is registered with the police, and every snare has to have an identification number on that and the regulation that goes with snaring. We've had stoke traps damaged, stoke traps tampered with, traps broken with stones. We've had fires deliberately started. You go in about Muirburn earlier on there, and we've also accepted that things can go horribly wrong. Some people go out there to perhaps point the finger. Rabbit boxes vandalised. We have had one keeper in an upland situation where he's actually had hidden cameras placed on the front door of his house, checking his family going in and out. Unacceptable. Unacceptable. That's something that's been worked on just now. We've had vandalism all over the place. I've experienced it. I keep her quite close to the town, and I've had my traps vandalised. I've had magpies released from traps, which is, you know, perhaps some people, they think that that's going to happen. But I've had one estate in particular, actually, has got its gamekeeping staff. They've given them personal vehicle and handheld cameras so that they're going to make sure that they're going to be within covered within the law. There's a lot going on, and there's a lot of things that can happen out there that if you go down the licensing route, totally licensed route, and you link licensing to that, that's happening already. That's going to continue to happen. We already see on social media that there are a number of people that actually actively tell people with respect to some of the raptor groups. I'm not pointing finger at anybody here, but some of the raptor groups actually pointing the finger at people saying, go out and check. So, you know, when you go into scrutiny, they're actually telling people to go out and check what's happening. That's happening. I can give you...
But with respect, Mr. Steele's already acknowledged the possibility, as he discussed his petition earlier, and has indicated that there would have to be something built into a licensing regime that took account of the possibility of estates being set up. Yeah. So, you know, I think everybody around the table recognises there is a risk, and it would have to be catered for if a licensing regime were to be introduced.
Definitely, yeah.
Does anybody else want to come back on Mark Ruskell's question? Sorry, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the second panel. Could I just get a bit of an understanding, a better understanding than I certainly have at the moment, about in terms of the forms of game bird hunting in Scotland. In the previous panel, it was mentioned by yourself, Logan, that there's the actual intensification process, which... correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand, in your view, has increased, certainly in some areas of Scotland in recent years. And then there's as well as the driven grouse moors, there's the what one would term the walk-up grouse moors. And I'm wondering if there's any way in which anyone in the panel can sort of shed any light on why that has increased so much, the intensification, and also whether the walk-up grouse moor situation for a business is much less productive in terms of the profits that it would create or not? Or is there any possibility of getting some sort of understanding of why these developments might be happening and whether maybe one might be better for wildlife and the environment more generally or not?
So, the main forms of game bird shooting in Scotland are the grouse, partridge and the pheasant shooting that go on. And I think we're basically talking about grouse shooting here. So walked up grouse shooting is a much, much lower key affair. It's much, you have considerably less employment that goes on within doing that, both through the gamekeeping staff, which would be dramatically reduced, but also through the beaters, the pickers up and everybody else that comes out on the day within that. And therefore, you end up with a lot less revenue coming into the areas where this takes part. You would also have considerably less income coming into the hotels, etc., that go on throughout that time of year. So you would end up with
a lot smaller businesses, a lot less employment in pretty fragile rural areas as they are at the moment, especially coming up with Brexit and the changing of subsidies that are going to go forward into the future. So there is no doubt considerably greater turnover within grouse moors that shoot driven grouse. It doesn't mean to say they're necessarily profitable within themselves, because a lot of the times these grouse moors do not make a profit. There is an assumption out there that they are profitable. Sometimes they make quite considerable losses, but people are prepared to invest that money within the communities to ensure that they're viable and they survive. But also within the environment you're talking about, within the grouse moors themselves, I think the studies down at Otterburn have shown that keepered grouse moors are good for things like curlews, lapwings, other species in there which benefit from the predator control that goes on with stoats, the weasels, foxes, etc.
But do they need to be managed as intensively as they appear to be managed? Is there not a happy medium to be struck?
It depends on, the clientele that they're looking to come and shoot. So the short answer is yes, in places I think they do need to be managed as intensively as they are in order to ensure that they achieve the surplus that people are coming to Scotland to spend, bring income, tourist income to come and...
But is that not at the root of the problem? Because that's what leads to the removal of birds of prey, because you cannot have birds of prey coexisting alongside that level of intensity.
Well, I'm sorry, but I think you can have birds of prey existing with that level of intensity. So this is where we're coming to the heart of the argument. And we've seen, as the RSPB survey from last year have shown, that the golden eagle populations are going up. And that's why you've got grouse moor owners up in the northeast taking part in the Heads Up for Hen Areas campaign. I think there's about 325,000 acres or so now signed up, asking for nest cameras to be come in to put on to the nests to view exactly what is going on, what's causing these problems, to try and address what is happening there.
Just to correct that, I'm afraid the National Golden Eagle Survey does not paint that picture at all. The actual results for the east of Scotland, the Area A, which is the Cairngorms National Park and Angus Glens and that part of eastern Scotland, shows that just over a third of all known golden eagle territories in that part of the world are occupied, and that the potential for golden eagle recovery there is massive, actually. And there are various other studies which point firmly at illegal persecution of golden eagles in that area as the main problem driving their low population status. And just to say, I think the other point, just with regards to the driven grouse system, is that it is unique in world terms. And many external observers from Europe and elsewhere who see it just say it simply wouldn't be allowed in their countries. It is not part of the culture of hunting. And I think Logan Steele alluded to it earlier. We have a tradition of sporting in this country rather than a culture of hunting. And this culture of sporting relies on having very high bag numbers of grouse. In some cases, autumn densities we're now seeing of 300-400, well, certainly over 300 per square kilometre for grouse moor owners and their clients to shoot. In the autumn in England, the densities are even higher. And these high densities have been brought about by a range of management factors, primarily medication of grouse, but also increased muir burn, heavier duty predator control, employing more gamekeepers per square kilometre to control predators. And, you know, one of the things that emerges from the SNH review of game bird licensing in other European countries is simply these kind of high-intensity models of game bird hunting don't exist. And I would suggest that that is part of the root of our problems.
OK, we'll come back to this.
Can I intensification as well? I think if you were going back to perhaps the 1930s, 1920s, 1930s, that's when you saw grouse shooting at its absolute highest. And that was when persecution was probably at its absolute highest. I think you probably find that over the years that the numbers have actually reduced. There's a lot of grouse moors that don't exist anymore. So, I mean, from that point of view, I think that the numbers perhaps just now are up and that could be down to the good practice that the keepers that are employed there to do are working well there to do. On that as well, there's another note that was made earlier about wildlife tourism. We have keepers on grousemuirs, on intensified grousemuirs, if you want to use that word, on well-managed grousemuirs, that actually have tour businesses coming up, wildlife tour businesses coming up onto the grousemuir with their clients to show them wildlife on a grousemuir, including raptors. That's happening in some of our members where they are up north.
Okay, let's move this on. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody, again. I mean, I'm interested in the environmental, economic, community or cultural impacts of a licensing system if it were to be introduced. I know we talked about it a little bit earlier. I'm also interested in just, I guess, the economic impacts, because I'm aware that it can cost a lot of money to shoot birds, you know, £70 a brace is two birds, and there's a minimum required. And it looks like estates, David Johnson's saying that there are finite margins. So can you help us understand a bit better about the economic impacts, or if we were to introduce a licensing system? Because I've seen that some of the estates can make lots of money, £10,000 to £30,000 even at a shoot or a day, or is it because the season's really short? I mean, what would the impacts be if there was a licensing system introduced?
Certainly no one in the Angus Glens that was alluded to earlier on, we did a scientific, it was for our own benefit really, but we did a report up there, and in three glens over the winter time, it's making somewhere in the region of £1 million, and that is for there. That was only for our own benefit. Certainly not any great. It showed that there are, you know, that it does have an impact on the economic side, jobs, all the rest of it that goes with any estate working, and that's the knock-on effect from everything. It goes absolutely everywhere. I think David will be best place for that.
That is not profit. So we're not talking about profit within this. So the economics of running a shoot, whether it's upland, lowland, or wherever else it is you have the staff that you're employing, the gamekeepers, etc., are employed throughout the full 12-month period. And then you have the add-on costs of maintenance of houses, etc., applied within that, and all the feed that comes in if you're on the lowland and all the rest of it. And what you find is that the money, it goes out considerably throughout the year, and then you have the period of time when the people come in to pay to shoot at whatever price you're talking about. I think sometimes a little bit more than that for driven grouse shooting. But at the end of the day, when you add it all up, you get a very large turnover within an area that filters through the area, be it on hotels or the schools or local shops and all the rest of it. But the actual profit within that business is very marginal. So these places are not making huge sums of money out of what they're doing. But the turnover and therefore the knock-on benefit to the wider communities is remarkable in places. I'm certainly down with us on the neighbouring valley in a low ground shoot. The hotel in the middle of town is now being completely rebuilt, transformed on the back of the local shooting, because they're able to fill the hotel for 80 bed nights throughout the winter, when otherwise they would be dead and the hotel had shut previously to that because it was no longer viable. And that then regenerates the whole town. So it is considerable.
I think, as Logan was hinting at earlier, I think you also need to look at the opportunity costs of this activity as well. So, you know, essentially we've been running a model for driven grouse shooting for nearly 200 years. Now the Scottish Government priorities are slightly different. We're looking at things like more diversified rural economies. We're looking at native woodland expansion, managing peatland areas for climate change, and so forth. And effectively, we have large areas of upland Scotland in particular that are sterilised under one land use, if you want to, sterilise is probably an extreme term, but you get the point, that are focused on one particular land use, that is driven grouse shooting, and you will not achieve these other objectives, and I would add the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy delivery as well, if you are going to continue to have so much land continuing under one particular land use.
The environmental issue, Angus MacDonald.
Yes, thanks, Karina. Yeah, sticking with the environmental impact and the point that Duncan or Ewing's just made. The panel will have heard Logan Steele detail earlier what he believes are the adverse environmental impacts associated with game bird hunting and the management of it. I'd be keen to hear the views of SLE and the SGA in particular on Logan Steele's comments earlier.
On the sustainability? I think that's the key element of the question you're asking.
Sustainability and the environmental impact.
Yes. So I think the key element within this, running any sporting enterprise, whether it's grass shooting or anything else, is that it has to be sustainable, because it has to be able to come back the year after that, the year after next year, etc., and be able to retreat. So the conservation within the ethos of running a sporting estate is absolutely right up to the top. And that doesn't include just the game bird species within that. It's the whole remit that benefit the wider environment within that. So I think it's a very good use of the land on that, from the grass moors up in that part of the country. It provides that both in economic benefit, but also the environment benefit that goes within it. You'll have seen that I think lapwings or curlews are now being moved on to the endangered list, the red list for the RSPB survey. And certainly my understanding is that some of the surveys down at Otterburn have shown that they do very well on keepered grass moors. So there is diverse benefit that takes place on these grass moors.
Okay. Do the SGA have a...
I've got a report here from the SEPA, SNH and SEPA, about the Muirburn. The Muirburn actually comes, although we've heard a lot about it here, it actually comes quite low down on the state of Scotland soils 2011, which grades soil threats in Scotland. Muirburn is at number 3. Compared to big part, it comes in at with the number 3, which is lower than forestry, for example, which is number 7. Development comes in at 8. Erosion and landslides, they are rated at 5. They're on a par with grazing, but a lot less than agricultural cultivation, which is at 18. So yes, I know there's Muirburn is always going to point. That there came out from the SNH, and it does show, as I said, when you look at it quite. It's not perhaps the root of all evil, as perhaps is made out to be, and it can be very beneficial from, obviously not just from the grouse point of view, but from the waders point of view as well, which, as we just heard, are certainly red-listed, and undoubtedly will benefit from the management that's carried out by keepers on moors. That's two things.
Out within the constraints of the Muirburn Code. And if you're burning deep peat, if you're burning out with a cycle of every 7 years, and if you're burning slopes that shouldn't be burned and therefore removing the habitat of hen harriers, it is having a detrimental effect.
I totally agree, but hopefully none of our members are doing that, and I don't know if they are, so I can't really comment on that one. But yeah, I would definitely agree that it then perhaps goes on to enforcement and that side of thing, which was alluded to earlier as well. And maybe some kind of enforcement that goes along with the Muirburn Code might be needed to be looked at by the SNH or whatever.
But that suggests the voluntary approach isn't working. It suggests that we do need to do something, whether it's licensing or whatever, that further action does need to be taken around some of these parts of the country.
Well, what I would say on that one is that if it's specific areas, then you're talking about, rather than a blanket across everybody, you target where you know the problem lies. If you know the problem lies in a particular area, then target that area. If you know it's in a particular glen, then go and target that particular glen. Does everybody need to get the rod of iron? If you know something's happening particularly somewhere, that's what the police would do. I'm quite certain if the Raptor Persecution Group came across a particular incident involving a raptor, the police will go and investigate that particular area. They target it.
Looking at the environmental benefits or disbenefits of intensive grouse management, Robbie Kernahan, how does the balance sit on this? Beneficial, non-beneficial, what?
Well, I think it's only fair to recognise that well-managed estates can provide huge environmental benefits. We know the benefits of pest and predator control for species which are of conservation concern. We know that the type of land management which takes place in our uplands, the burning, the managed grazing, does provide biodiversity benefit. Indeed, we've recognised that for a long time. We manage these habitats in that transitional phase, which is almost unique to Scotland, and it's internationally recognised. So there is biodiversity benefit from upland management and from the benefits of keepering. I suppose the question is, at what point do we see those biodiversity benefits change when the intensification of land management begins to persist? And that's not an easy question to answer. I mean, I suppose going back to some of the questions about the existing legislative framework and the purpose of this work, when we were first commissioned to undertake a review of what happens in other European countries, it was very much with a recognition that the current framework in Scotland is, you know, it transposes the Birds Directive into the Wildlife and Countryside Act. So that is the current framework which we operate in. What we try and do in operating that framework, we issue 3,000 licences a year under that Act, or various licensing regimes in Scotland, about 300 licences a year. And what we try and do is apply the principles of better regulation. So we try to be targeted, we try to be proportionate, and we try to be risk-based. If there is any appetite for introducing any additional regulatory system, I suspect that would be the principles we would be trying to adhere to.
Okay, that takes us on to Kate Forbes' questions.
Great, thanks very much. So we've obviously had quite a wide-reaching conversation about the current regulatory regime. I would just like to ask what you think are the next steps in terms of regulating the crime that does happen. So there's been various points made about you can never have a perfect system because crime will always exist. But nevertheless, we presumably want to be moving forward to a state where raptors are increasing and there isn't any persecution. So what are your views in terms of the current regulatory regime? Where is it failing? Where might we improve it?
So can I respond? So I think Scotland is recognised as having good wildlife protection laws in general. The issue, as we heard earlier, is one of enforcement of those good laws that the Scottish Parliament has put in place. And we would certainly, it was mentioned earlier that there is consideration being given to the SSPCA in increasing their powers slightly over and above what they have now. We think that would certainly help with some of the enforcement side. But what we have also seen, and this review, this SNH review has really shown that, is that in Scotland, we are unique in many senses that we do not have an effective game bird licensing system amongst the European countries that have been studied. Our focus and our concerns mostly surround the driven grouse shooting issue and the intensification of management and the sort of business model that involves the illegal killing of birds of prey. But we recognise that it may not be possible to actually design a system that just focuses on that form of hunting, that it may have to go wider and sadly encompass all forms of game bird hunting. And, you know, I mean, what we are suggesting is that a licensing system might be attached to a code, which we have in other forms of natural resources management, a statutory code, which clearly defines the public interest and what people that are managing the land need to adhere to. And that would include things like hare culling and muir burn and some of the other things that are being raised at this forum as public interest concerns. It's also worth noting that in the report, the European Commission has called for well-regulated hunting and stipulated that the essential characteristics of sustainable hunting include hunting within the framework of a management plan, which we don't have, temporary and permanent no-take zones, which we don't have, full compliance with the law, which we don't have, awareness raising and training both of hunters and environmentalists. We have that partially. We were hearing earlier, but in some countries they have formal tests that hunters have to go through to identify quarry species, for example. Willingness to assess impacts of hunting and adapt sustainable practices where problems are identified, which we don't have entirely. Collection of good quality data. Most countries have compulsory bag returns and the equivalents of SNH collect bag data, which informs and helps set hunting quotas and identifies whether species should be hunted or not. We don't have that in place either. So, you know, we think there's quite a bit of work to be done here, and certainly the RSPB view is that all of these issues are best encapsulated within a formal licensing regime.
We still have a significant raptor persecution issue. How do we address that? If not a licensing regime, then what more needs to be done? What else needs to be done?
So within Europe, we have a quite different style of hunting, as we talked about, whereby it's very much the individuals going out into the countryside, a lot of it's on public land, which is why you have the licensing system that's aimed over there. And the idea behind that is to make sure that the people who are going out there are hunting sustainably the species that they're going to hunt, and they don't overexploit it. In Scotland, we have a very different model, whereby people are coming to shoot the driven birds and that sort of thing. And that in itself is, I think, well run by the industry. There is problems within raptor persecution, which we've been working very, very strongly with the PAWS working group. Now, we have absolutely no issue at all with strengthening PAWS. We're looking at how we can make that better, introducing regional PAWS groups to get better relationships going on within the industry. I think the regulatory framework that's been brought into place is working. I think it has made a marked difference to both compliance, both the understanding and the education within the industry itself. But I think there's a lot of work still to be done within that, and I think that's where PAWS comes in. I also think that's where the likes of Wildlife Estates Scotland comes in, because within that we've got just over 1 million acres now within Wildlife Estates Scotland, which does include things like management plans of game, etc., and not just game, it's about way, way, way more than just the game species, it's about all the other species that exist within the state. And I think that should be further strengthened, and we've been trying to get the government to provide more support for that, and we would very much encourage them to do so. So I think it's about better good practice, better education, getting out there and getting people to understand exactly what they need to be doing.
Andy Smith.
Yeah, I think one of the other things that has to be considered as well is that we've already had the Posty recommendation for tougher sentencing. That is undoubtedly going to be going to help as well. If you know you're going to go to jail to do something, then you're maybe going to have to think twice before you do something. That makes sense. The firearms legislation as well that we talked about, perhaps linking wildlife crime in some way to an absolute, along the firearms guidelines. Certainly the police will now take guns off people and take their license, remove them. They may certainly remove their guns, they might not revoke their license. So they might have their license, which is valid for 5 years, but they might not actually have their weapons to do that, to do the job. That might be something that might be looked at in a way of trying to deter those individuals that do go out there and still do things. We've already got the general license has been removed in from a couple of places now. I think a couple of places now, where two or three places now, where the general license has been removed from estates, and rightly so. That is another way, if you like, that you can be looked at. Enforcement officers, perhaps, if you were, for example, some kind of SNH enforcement officer, that could actually physically go onto the ground and check out what's happening, especially in these areas where they've already lost their general license. These are other things as well, and I agree with Paul. PAW is another way of definitely moving things forward. From what I understand, anyway, the PAW Highland seems to be doing very well, and maybe that's something that needs to be rolled out throughout the rest of the country.
Okay. Maurice Golden.
Thanks, convener. We've heard a clear differential in terms of the standard of proof between a licensing regime and the current status quo. But beyond that, I mean, Duncan Orr-Ewing gave a list there in terms of management plans, formal tests, assessments, data collections, none of which are predicated on a licensing system. So I'm interested in terms of the panel's views, particularly around that list, but also around policing and enforcement. in terms of a differential between a licensing system and the current regime. So, for example, if you put in a licensing regime but still cannot police it effectively or catch any criminal activity or civil activity as it would be in a licensing regime, then you're no further forward.
Duncan, are you?
So clearly, if there's a criminal burden of proof, we have the laws in place that, and you know that that should proceed through the normal procurator fiscal approach. And if there's sufficient evidence, then that should be heard in court. I don't think we have any issue with that. But we've heard earlier that getting that evidence in the first place, given that a lot of these crimes involving wildlife, particularly bird of prey crimes, occur in remote areas. It's easy to conceal the evidence. We know that people are actually using new technology to try and conceal their activities. So, you know, use of thermal imaging gear and that kind of thing, which so a lot of this activity is probably happening at night now rather than during the day. People are using are not using techniques that are more easily discoverable, like illegal poisoning. And so what we see is a licensing system sitting underneath that. So we have the good laws that we have in Scotland for criminal burden of proof. But underneath, we have a licensing system that works, as we've heard recently, and have, as we've heard in relation to the open general license. And licensing systems generally work on balance of probabilities. And as Logan Steele was intimating, it would be a civil burden of proof that would apply. This would be a layered approach, so you would envisage that information would go to SNH from the police, and then on the balance of probabilities, that they would weigh up the evidence to see whether it was sufficient to require the removal of a hunting licence or whatever system we have in place. And, you know, we would like to see an inquiry that is set up by this committee that actually looks into this whole issue, designs a system that is appropriate for Scottish circumstances, involves all relevant stakeholders, and designs a system that is workable in practice. So that's the way we would look at it.
So that's purely on a kind of standard of proof basis, which I think the point's been made both sides. I was interested to see if there were other aspects of the licensing regime that had particular advantages over the current status quo.
Duncan, are you able to take that point up? Raptor persecution provokes great passion. Do you accept that there would be a risk of estates being set up by individuals who were fired up about the subject of raptor persecution, and that there would be a danger if the regime was not structured in such a way to protect that burden of proof element, that you could have estates, land managers penalised when they were innocent?
So I'm not, I accept there is a risk, but I'm not sure there is any evidence that has come to court of people setting up estates in the way that you've described. And clearly, you know, interfering with traps and the like, that's already a criminal offence. So, you know, there are criminal offences in place to deal with some of these issues.
But if you had a licensing regime, is it possible that individuals might be more encouraged to behave in that way? I'm speculating here.
Yeah, I suspect not. And clearly, I mean, if a licence, the ultimate sanction would be to remove a licence from somebody, which ultimately might result in them not being able to operate their business. We accept that is a stringent sanction. So clearly, the burden of proof, the civil burden of proof that the police and SNH would consider, as they have done recently with the open general licences, and they've removed that on the basis of evidence that the police have given them, it would have to work in a similar way, I would suggest. So there would still be strong checks and balances in the system.
Andy Smith wanted to come back.
I was quite surprised to hear Duncan saying that he was very surprised that people wouldn't do it. They do it now when there's not a licensing system. Not come to court is something very, very, an unusual word as well. Yes, it might not have come to court, but they're certainly there. It's got to the stage in some places that there is that much damage to property or illegality that basically the police have almost said, look, there's nothing we can do about this. It actually works almost the same way in the raptor crime, because it's happening out in the country. A dog walker comes across a larson trap, lets a magpie out of a larson trap and walks on. Nobody knows. There is a lot of illegality happening out there, and I'll recount a story, if I may, for you on that one. Two farmers in Middleton, down in the borders, have lapwings, curlews on their border. They shoot. They don't have any... No driven birds there. They don't release any birds there, but they shoot what's on the ground. They are quite keen to see lapwings, curlews, what have you, going about the place. Last year, I got a phone call from they're both our members. got a phone call from them to say that magpies have been released out of the Lassen traps. Magpies at this time of the year will predate on chicks and eggs. So they put the Lassen traps out. They try and catch the Lassen. They try and catch the magpies, which they're allowed to do under the general licence. They basically, cut a long story short, because it is long, they put a camera onto this trap after it had been twice, it had been released by a dog walker. The police were involved in that. The wildlife officer went along to the woman's house. But interestingly enough, she actually also reset the trap. So she allowed the magpie out off the trap. She then reset the trap. That trap was set with, or the food stuff inside for the baited bird was rabbit. Had a buzzard gone into that trap, it would have been a completely different thing. These guys could have lost their single farm payments as far as that. And that was just pure and simply on the individual actions of somebody that did not go to court. The police, when they went along, I spoke to the wildlife cop later on, because it's a very grey area. There's not a specific piece of legislation for actually releasing a call bird from a Lassen trap. There's plenty about Lassen traps, but the actual specific of releasing a bird when it's in there, there isn't there. So there's a lot going on already without a licensing system. Whether a licensing system would help that or not, I certainly don't think so. And it would then go into other things, David.
Mr. Golden touched on the issue of policing. One of the reasons we are where we are today is because of the difficulty in getting convictions and solving raptor crime. Can you hand on heart say that as well as utterly condemning, as both of your organisations have, this kind of activity, that your members are as proactively cooperative with the police when they're investigating these kind of activities as they could be?
I think we are. I think, more recently, and I'm no doubt I will be corrected if I'm wrong here, the latest eagle that went missing, the keepers on the estate offered to help look for that bird as well, and their offer was refused. That's the most recent case.
David happened. Johnson.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to expand on that. In the sense, you've got a satellite tag went missing there, and an investigation was rightly conducted, etc. And the estate was offering to help and show where the eagle was, where they believed it to be. It has subsequently been filmed. We don't know whether it is that eagle or not. I mean, ideally, we want to work to find out what is going on there. But the cooperation, the level of trust within that, is poor, and that reflects badly on trying to work the framework going forward. And the other thing I'd say is that Duncan, a minute ago, made quite a lot of accusations about practices that are going on within the countryside, which is pretty strong. And I don't recognise that. I think that should be challenged from the point of view of your accusing our members of conducting all sorts of nefarious activity. If we're going to do this, we're going to get to the bottom of this, it has to be based on evidence. We have to get hard evidence of what is going on, and make legislation and act according to that.
Richard Lyle wants to come in.
There's one point, I listened very intently to your points, and I can see where both are coming from. Can you also tell me about, you know, and you're related to the story, can you also tell me about what involvement in regard to raptor crime is poachers involved in? Is there any, you know, what?
The only thing probably with regarding to, and probably you're better asking probably some of the experts on the raptors. I would imagine rather than the only poaching thing I would be probably egg thieves. Yeah. Would be the only ones I could think about rather than, you know, poachers. I don't think, you know.
I mean, there's just collecting of the eggs for some people, which is
very much a declining issue.
Yeah. It's something that I thought no one had mentioned yet. So, okay, thanks.
Mr. Lyle, do you want to go on to a line of question?
Yeah, if I can turn to Dr. Sheddon of the British Association of Shooting and Conservation. argued in the evidence to the Public Petitions Committee that the current regulations in Scotland are unusually stringent. In light of the findings of the, you were talking about the review, the Gamebird review, is Dr. Sheridan correct to state the regulations in Scotland are unusually stringent? And if they are, why would we need changes in the law?
So I think, I don't think he is correct to say that. I mean, we've heard reference several times here to firearms legislation. Firearms legislation is stringent in most of the 14 countries that have been reviewed here. What is different is that we don't have a formal licensing system for hunting of game birds in Scotland, and that contrasts, to be honest, that contrasts with most other forms of natural resources management that go on in Scotland, so for deer management, for water, for wild fisheries. We have regulations in place. We have authorities that oversee the management of those natural resources. So, for example, in the case of water, it's SEPA. In the case of wild deer, it's SNH. The exception to the rule is game bird hunting. We do not seem to have any licensing system which sets the standards to which people that hunt game birds in Scotland should adhere to. And apart from the voluntary ones that we heard of from the sector earlier on, and which we, you know, we support voluntary codes, but we don't think they're working. They're not doing enough to combat what we see, which is the real hard-edged problem of the illegal killing of birds of prey and other unsustainable management practices that are currently going on grouse moors. And frankly, we think they're getting worse. The problems are getting worse, not better.
I mean, the government statistics show that they're not getting worse, but we'll argue backs and forwards over that. I think to answer your question, which is a little bit, I mean, Duncan, you've already said that the regulatory framework is sufficient in place within this country. To answer your question specifically, I think it is quite draconian within that. If you take vicarious liability, so if an employee of yours, doesn't matter if it's a gamekeeper, it could be anybody out doing it, is convicted or charged of wildlife crime, then you as an employer are automatically in the line for vicarious liability. It happens automatically. And now, whether that prosecution is taken forward or not, it's dependent upon whether you've got the safeguards in place and you have clearly instructed that person to not do it. And that's a matter for the crime prosecution to decide. But furthermore, there doesn't have to be a conviction of your employee for you to be charged with vicarious liability. So from an owner's perspective, you very much now are exposed, and you are there. Your head is on the line, and you have to ensure that good practice is adhered to. Otherwise, you run the risk, and it's you personally who is liable for it.
Right, we've got 14 countries who've got different looking at that. And okay, we've got hunting and different, you know, history in Scotland, various the way that we've done it. But sitting here as an ordinary person, mm-hmm. I'm saying, you know, the regulations that we have in these different countries, can we not have a pick and mix and get together? You know, Mr. Steele said earlier on that when he went to talk to some of your members, they didn't want to talk to him. You know, we have suggestions of, bear with me, we have suggestions of instances where people are burning, destroying, doing things that they shouldn't be doing because you want to sustain your business, you want to improve the business, allegedly. So why can't two parties, we've got basically three parties here who are all talking, you know, saying, no, it's not me, it's not, I didn't do it. So why can't you all get together, sit down and design regulations? And Mr. Steele, you want a law, but you haven't suggested what should be in the law. You know, you're basically saying, well, you're the lawyers, you go and construct it. If you're coming to say you want something, you've got to tell us what you want. But I can't see why you three organisations can't sit down and work out what needs to be done to sustain what I would suggest is a very important economic situation in Scotland in order to survive.
Can I just say that this is my 40th year of monitoring raptors, and we've been trying to negotiate and talk and reason with the shooting industry, and if I could go back in a TARDIS to 40 years ago, we'd have the same discussion. We've tried and tried and tried to try and move away from this killing of raptors, and that's what's brought us here today. So I know outside looking in, it seemed a sensible thing to do, but take it from me, please. We've talked and talked and talked, and it's got nowhere.
I totally agree with you. And the point is, before we have to legislate, you will have to sit down and he has a need, you have a need, and you have a need. Why don't you get together and get a need that suits everyone?
The short answer to that's exactly what PAWS is designed to do. That is to bring the parties together to understand exactly what is going on and to discuss and work out the issues and drive it forward. And it has made a difference. I'm sorry, but it has made a difference. And that's what we need to strengthen it. We're all for strengthening, looking at it, reviewing it, finding out where it can be improved, made better. No problem with that whatsoever.
It will have crossed your mind that there may be a licensing regime brought forward. It's perhaps a slightly unfair question, but I'll ask it anyway. Have you looked through these 14 countries and wondered about Dick Lyle's suggestion of a pick and mix, that you could pick things from various regimes and come up with a licensing regime that was robust, brought about improvement, but also protected estates from potentially being set up?
How best to answer that one? So there's no doubt. I think what this review does is it does provide just a bit of clarity about how some of the Birds Directive is being interpreted and implemented in other member states. And that's a really useful reference point for us in Scotland. As we've heard today, the situation in Scotland is culturally very different from other member states, and as is the regulatory framework. To pick up on Mr. Lyle's point and Colin Shedden's comments, we have the least regulated system in Europe. Now, we can debate whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, but the reality is that the state, in terms of how it intervenes in hunting, is not very well developed or pronounced in Scotland. We don't have the type of relationship with individual hunters or sporting businesses in terms of understanding the data which is being generated, either in terms of sustainable harvest or data coming back. Now, there are merits, there are pros and cons to each of these models, and I think what this report does is just highlight that there is no silver bullet in terms of a licensing regime. If ministers have got an appetite for additional regulation in Scotland, of course, the sensible thing to do would be to speak to all of those affected parties and come up with something which we think best reflects the needs and demands of Scotland in the 21st century. But it's not that long ago, whilst the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act was being consulted on in seeking to modernise game law, we did away with a licensing regime which required hunters to register. So in terms of making sure we've got legislation which is fit for purpose, we need to ensure that public interest is firmly driving that. And in all of those case studies, I think they rely on either that developed ethos of shared understanding and trust, which we have in Scotland to a certain extent, because that's what general licences are based upon. It's when we lose that trust or confidence do we begin to exercise a more informed and more interventionist approach to regulation. I think if we've got any appetite in Scotland, then that's the type of direction we should be going.
Okay, Finlay Carson.
I'm a bit confused. There does seem to be a general consensus that the legislation we've got in place is fit for purpose, and we have a government that has taken steps to put that legislation in place. Is it not quite simply we need the commitment from the government to provide the resources to police that legislation, full stop?
Both. So we have good legislation. At the moment, we have inadequate enforcement of that legislation. There is a proposal to give the Scottish SPCA more powers, which would certainly help. But even that is not going to be the silver bullet. So it's still the evidential process is difficult to actually bring cases to court. What we are suggesting is that a licensing system sits under that. I mean, some court cases will proceed where the evidence is sufficient, but in the many cases where that criminal burden of proof is not available, then we need a process that sits underneath that and is complementary, such as a licensing system. I mean, we are not anti-game bird hunting, provided it's carried out sustainably. But what we feel the next step here would be an inquiry that actually looks into how a Scottish system of licensing of game bird hunting in Scotland might work in practice, involves all the key stakeholders, which include all the people that are sitting at this table today. We get a bespoke system that is appropriate for Scottish circumstances. I'm afraid the pause, which David Johnston alluded to, the pause system is focused on wildlife crime and improving the enforcement and detection and deterrence to wildlife crime. It is not constructed to look at this kind of licensing issue. It's also not considering some of the sustainability issues that we've talked about, sort of sustainable management of some of these moorland areas, which the SNH Scientific Advisory Committee review has looked into, and which are part of this equation and are perhaps best dealt with in some form of statutory code that sits alongside a licensing system, we would suggest.
To ask, I read the SNH report and perhaps I've missed this. We know that despite the presence of licensing regime in these countries, there is still a raptor persecution issue. Do you have figures that show whether the introduction of licensing regimes led to a decrease, an increase, or no effect at all on raptor persecution in these countries?
I think, Convener, even from the report itself, there will be an easier tale to tell based on which member states implemented which, and I think we've already referred to Spain already this morning, where there is quite a clear delineation between increased enforcement and fines, which has led to a reduction in raptor persecution, but I don't think we'll have that for all member states.
Okay.
The one thing which I would reinforce, again, the key to the success of any licensing regime, whether it's in Scotland or in these member states, it does require a significant commitment to police them and enforce them. And that's, again, part of the problem we have in Scotland. Whether we operate within the current system or indeed look to introduce a new licensing regime, whether it's a civil burden of proof or a criminal burden of proof, there will still be a resource requirement to make sure the system works.
And it would be a considerable resource requirement for SNH.
Well, I can't predict what a new system may or may not look like, but if the expectation is that SNH take on any additional licensing requirements, then yes, there would be significant resource.
Okay, thank you. Mark Roswell.
I think you've covered some of the areas, Convener, but I was going to ask SNH really in conclusion, I mean, what is your view about the environmental impact of a licensing system for driven grouse shooting? Would that have positive environmental impacts or not?
Well, depending on what system was implemented, Mark, I think it's quite difficult to say categorically yes or no. I mean, we're working within the existing legislative framework just now. That's what we're tasked with doing. We're trying to strengthen it where we can, and the examples of taking a better regulatory approach to general licensing, I think, is a step forward. We've got some confidence that we can operate in that civil burden of proof within the existing framework. Now, the judicial review case, which came to court 2 weeks ago, demonstrated that we can restrict general licenses and operate a much more informed licensing regime currently. But that's just for managing commonplace, well-established activities in relation to control of corvids, principally. Whether we have got an appetite or whether we see additional benefit from additional regulation of grouse moor management, I don't have the answer to that.
Something you don't have a view on at this point, but would there be ways to bring regulations together, effectively to streamline and bring a regulatory process together into one place through a licensing regime? Could it simplify or would it complicate?
Well, there is no doubt that the existing Wildlife and Countryside Act would benefit from consolidation, in my view, because it has been amended so many times that in trying to police it, enforce it, and take cases to court, actually, the existing legislative framework is quite confused because it's been amended so many times. So there may be benefit in consolidating wildlife legislation, yes. Whether that includes any additional refinements to incorporate new codes or some of the existing best practice guides, I don't think I've got a strong view on. What I can say is that we're working within the current system as effectively as we can just now, and some of the work, the proactive work, which is, I think, helping, certainly through PAWS, through the Moorland Forum, by developing principles of best practice on moorland management into mountain hare, into muirburn, into a whole host of things, is actually making progress. The question is, are we seeing that progress, the kind of pace and results that we might all like to see? Even with legislative change, it takes time. I think Kate Forbes mentioned earlier on, even vicarious liability is still relatively new. So it's a question of pace for me and whether or not we want to see in, continued acceleration of progress or not.
Can I just ask, just finally, for some clarity, is it the view of the sector, the industry, that a licensing regime could lead to a ban on driven grass moor shooting? Is that the view of the conservationists as well? Or is it about reforming and improving and reinforcing best practice?
I don't know if it's...
Do you see a risk?
I don't absolutely know if it's absolutely necessary. I think, going back to what Ms. Carson said, I think that we've got plenty in place just now that perhaps need better policed. And one thing we do have, just to go back to your thing, that we have, and we're quite lucky in this country that we do have it. We've got the Crown Office and PF Service, which are accountable and justifiable to the Scottish Government. They will look at all the evidence that's there. And that is one thing, no matter what. It's an individual's right. You're innocent until proven guilty.
But my point is, that, is your fear that a licensing regime could lead to a de facto ban because the bar would be so high for driven grassmoor estates to...
I think it's probably one for you, David.
To give a short answer, I think probably the answer is yes. I mean, within... Some of the groups that are looking for changes, I think some of the motives are against the driven shooting of game, and that's something that they would like to see achieved, which would have a great detrimental effect within it. I think there is a risk within lowering the burden of proof, as we started off in the first conversation, that it would lead to the ceasing of driven shooting in Scotland. Yeah, certainly downscaling of it.
What's the view of the conservationists on that?
Well, to be clear, our policy is not to support a ban on driven grouse shooting. Our policy is one of licensing of driven grouse shooting. I mean, we see this process of one of both improving enforcement of public interests and improving the standards that apply as apply in other forms of natural resources management. We've heard that we are very much gamebird shooting is very much the exception to the rule. Other forms of natural resources management are regulated, and I just refer also to page 8 of the SNH report, which highlights that the countries, so we have licensing systems in place across 14 countries that have been studied in this report, but it says on page 8, the countries with the most significant problem with the illegal killing of predatory birds included the UK and Spain. We certainly see a licensing system as helpful in setting the public interest more clearly, defining the standards which should apply to the management of driven grouse shooting, and helping to tackle some of the long-standing and intractable problems around bird of prey persecution. And a final point on this, to say that the RSPB is not invested in sort of conflict resolution process heavily would be wide of the mark. I mean, we've been involved in the Langham demonstration project, for example, for many years, which helped, as one of its outputs, to develop a mechanism of diversionary feeding of hen harriers, so to prevent hen harriers from predating red grouse chicks, which was highlighted as an industry concern. We have a method now which is highly successful, very effective, but are we seeing any of the driven grouse sector actually using that technique? No, we're not.
Some might disagree with that, but let's not go there. I'm conscious that when a number of members had indicated to me an interest in particular questions, as I read it, I think we've pretty much covered everything we were going to, but I'll leave it open to members. Has anyone got a final question they want to ask, or a number of final questions? Claudia Beamish.
If it's possible to hear from Logan Steele, if there was any comment on the evidence that you've heard in this second session, if you wanted to make any comment on it as a petitioner.
I've nothing further to either that's been said by myself this morning or just now. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, on that note, can I thank everyone for giving evidence today? It's been very useful in informing our thinking. As agreed earlier, I obviously thank the witnesses for their attendance. As agreed earlier, we'll now move into private session, and I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is closed. Thank you.